talks with Israel's new tourism minister about why pilgrims continue to flock there. And Pastor Mark Lantz concludes an appropriate series on how to stay grateful during difficult times. Hopefully that's not your Thanksgiving or the next hour, as the Harvest Show is just getting started. Wednesday before Thanksgiving, in a lot of places, it's a holiday, work stops, education perhaps stops, but not for the kids at St. Joe High School. Their broadcast news class is here today observing this show, learning how not to do television. How you doing, everybody? Alongside our CEO, Pete Summerall, and Pastor Mark Lantz, Chuck Freebie, welcome to another edition of The Harvest Show.
Oh, that's funny. All right, Chuck, now what are you going to teach them not to do?
Well, first of all, I'm going to teach them how to do an opening segment in an award-winning style, and that's why we have Christian television's fastest-growing talk sensation today. It's a little segment we like to call Choose Your News. Pastor Mark, I realize you don't often get a chance to play Choose Your News.
This is my first time, actually. Uh-huh.
Yeah. So I will. Typically, I'll go to the head honcho and give him a shot.
No, you go to
today, you have your choice of stories from London, Indianapolis, or Washington, D.C.
Oh, let's go Washington, D.C. Have to go our nation's capital.
This is an opinion piece that ran in the Washington Post. It was titled, Stop Pitting Security and Compassion Against Each Other in the Syrian Refugee Crisis. And I'll kind of pick it up midway here. This is written by Russell Moore. It says, it's completely right to ensure the United States have a strong process to discern who are truly refugees and who are trying to take advantage of refugees. That's why we need a clearer and stronger articulation of what kind of system will be put in place by our government to properly vet anyone seeking to enter as a refugee. At the same time, evangelical Christians cannot be the people who turn our back on the mission field. We should be the ones calling the rest of the world to remember the image of God and inalienable human dignity of persecuted people, whether Christian, Jewish, Muslim, or Yazidi, especially those fleeing from genocidal Islamic terrorists. Hmm. This kind of picks up on what we were talking about at the end of the show yesterday, in that delicate balancing act for all of us in regards to security and yet compassion.
Exactly. Well, again, as we talked about yesterday, as believers, we want to reach out to those that are suffering. But it is our government's obligation to protect our nation. That's the number one thing that we have to be aware of as well. So there's got to be this process whereby we're able to see those that are coming to do damage to the United States of America.
He goes on to compare it to the Holocaust in the 20th century, that people ignored the fact that the Jewish people were being sent to these camps, and says we can have disagreements about how to maintain security. He says what we cannot do is demagogue the issue.
It's really a very big challenge right now. Mm-hmm. I mean, who do you decide, frankly, are going to be a radical, who's not going to be a radical? And I do think our nation has to be very careful about that. We cannot discriminate against any particular group of people. Right. But at the same time, I've read some articles lately, there's been probably more Christians who have been denied access to the United States than people of other faiths and other religions. And so something clearly is not working in our process. Mm-hmm. I have read where a number of other countries, Canada, for instance, is in the news today, that they're changing their immigration policy, that individuals from the Middle East who are single young men are not going to be allowed to come into Canada because they don't trust them. But if you're a family, if you've got a family, if you've got kids, a husband and wife, et cetera, no matter what your faith is, you're going to be welcome to Canada. That's probably actually a pretty wise direction, you know, for Canada to take. And I hope the United States does something very similar. Mm-hmm.
Okay, two cities you frequented in your life, London and Indianapolis.
Oh, let's do London. Been
all
there
right.
Just the last few weeks.
Very interesting story out of there. This ran in the New York Times. Based on the Lord's Prayer, a 60-second commercial, which was to be shown before Star Wars The Force Awakens, when it opens next month, has been refused screen time in most of Britain's movie theaters. The decision to reject the advertisement has been criticized by the Church of England, which commissioned it. The church says it's bewildered by the move and claimed it could have a chilling effect on free speech. And on Monday, Prime Minister David Cameron was equally direct, describing the decision as ridiculous.
The Queen and other people who are really authorities in the United Kingdom have all said this is absolutely wrong. This is political correctness gone absolutely the wrong direction. We've got to stop it, whether it's in the United States or in the United Kingdom or France. I mean, I think France right now and Belgium are dealing with a political correctness gone wrong, where they've just said, okay, everything's okay. Well, you know what? Not everything is okay all the time. And, you know, we have to stand for our rights. So it's really a very touchy issue.
For its sake, the movie theater, Digital Cinema Media, says it has a policy of not accepting political or religious content for use in its cinemas. So I wonder if that comes to the movies that play as well.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, how does that reflect to all the movies that go along, you know, that are, frankly, in a lot of ways, very political? So, I mean, could The Hunger Games be aired then in that cinema?
Right.
I mean,
you've got
a group of people who, frankly, are against the central government in The Hunger Games. So is that going to be politically correct? Can that air in that cinema or not?
I wouldn't think so.
No.
And I wouldn't think so at all.
No.
And I like The Hunger Games movies.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it's huge.
Now, to play devil's advocate, you open yourself to what if there was a Muslim group that came in and wanted to basically do pro-Islamic State ads before a movie?
As long as it's not anti anything else, I don't think you can stop it.
Right.
I wouldn't like it. I wouldn't appreciate it. But at the same time, I don't think you can stop it as long as it's not anti anything else. And it's same thing with our Christian faith.
Right.
You know, one of the things we deal with Middle East television is that we are absolutely welcome and open to preach the gospel. We can tell people what we believe. We can tell people that there's salvation through Jesus Christ. But at the same time, we cannot condemn any other religion in Israel. I agree with that. Mm-hmm. That's actually a good policy. And, you know, we believe what we believe. We believe it's the way to heaven. We believe Jesus Christ is the path to salvation. But at the same time, we don't necessarily have to go against any other religion to get to that point.
Right.
And by the way, those 20 seconds you just saw of that spot on YouTube are 20 seconds more than you would see of it in a London movie theater. But the ad was basically 60 seconds of people in different situations praying the Lord's Prayer. Mm-hmm. And that's the spot that's been denied in the London movie theater. We want to know your thoughts as well. So check us out on Facebook, Twitter, email us at live@lesea.com. You know, one of the reasons I wanted to bring these stories to your attention today is they come from secular newspapers. They're not religious tomes that are, it's the way Christianity is being prepared in the secular media and being portrayed. And that's one of the things these young people who are with us today are learning, is what it's like to represent Christianity in the world, but not necessarily be of the world. And that's why we think it's important to have them here and learn today. The international news is next. You're watching The Harvest Show on the LeSEA Broadcasting Network.
If ever the Middle East needed to see Jesus, it's now. Your gift today will help METV broadcast the gospel to millions of people in Syria, Iraq, Israel, and other countries throughout the region. You'll take Christ's love into areas where missionaries are not allowed to go. Give now, and we'll send you a copy of Dr. Lester Sumrall's book, Why the World Will Hail the Antichrist. Visit LeSEA.com, that's LeSEA.com, and give your best gift today.
This Wednesday, November 25th, 2015, here's what's happening in your world. The Turkish President Recep Erdogan says his country does not want to escalate tensions with Russia over the downing of a warplane. Speaking at an Organization of Islamic Cooperation Economy meeting in Istanbul, Erdogan says Turkey favors peace, dialogue, and diplomacy. Erdogan, however, defended his country's action in shooting down the plane. He said the Russian pilot had been warned 10 times in 5 minutes. The Iranian foreign minister, Mohammad Javad Zarif, said Tuesday's incident deteriorates the situation in the region. He warned any escalation could benefit extremists. Iran is a major ally of Syrian President Bashar Assad's government and has backed the Russian airstrikes in Syria. The Russian President Vladimir Putin denounces what he calls a stab in the back and warned Turkey of significant consequences. There are many, though, who believe Russia's actions are fueling a drive towards jihad within its own borders. 2 decades of Russia's war on Islamic insurgency, mainly in Chechnya and Dagestan, have fostered a generation of cutthroat Islamist fighters and given rise to a culture of violence and police profiling. It has pushed conservative religious groups to the margins of society and into the jaws of extremist groups. The Salafi movement is extremely popular with young Muslims. They dismiss Sufi preachers as serving the government and who are willing to condone corruption and abuse. Some see Salafism as a chance to attain a purer, stricter religion. Salafis are often viewed as sympathetic to the Islamic militants and thus considered a security threat, although only a small fraction of Salafis in Dagestan are believed to support Islamic State. Russian officials have defended the police profiling and raids on suspected militants' homes, describing them as preventive steps to stave off radicalization and deter possible attacks. Students in Brussels began returning to class today after a 2-day shutdown over fears that a series of simultaneous attacks could be launched around the Belgian capital. Special measures were being taken at primary and secondary schools, plus universities, with student movements limited around or outside school buildings during the day.
Well, I suppose the alert level is quite reasonable. Otherwise, they wouldn't open the schools, they wouldn't open the metro system. So I think it's a really good sign for the city.
Belgian authorities set the city on maximum alert overnight Friday amid warnings of an imminent security threat. More than 1,000 security personnel and soldiers have been deployed. Protesters took to Chicago streets overnight. The demonstration started after police released a dash cam video showing the 2014 shooting death of a black teen by a white police officer. That officer, Jason Van Dyke, was charged with murder Tuesday. The officer fired 16 shots in just 30 seconds at 17-year-old Laquan McDonald, who had a 3-inch knife with its blade folded into the handle. Protesters tried to block traffic on an expressway before walking towards a lakefront park. A few yelled at police officers, others chanted as they blocked a street. Protest groups are expected to stage more demonstrations in the days ahead. One is scheduled at City Hall for today. Another seeks to block Michigan Avenue during Friday's holiday shopping bonanza. And a major wildfire near the southern Australian city of Adelaide has destroyed homes and cars and left one person hospitalized with serious burns. About 200 firefighters and a number of aircraft are fighting the wildfire as it sweeps past towns including Malala and Wasleys.
It's a fast-moving and very dangerous fire, but the crews are working as hard as they can to protect communities and property. The wind change that's gone through is expected to abate a little bit around about 9 o'clock tonight, and hopefully we'll be able to get the upper hand on that fire into the evening.
Power has been cut to thousands of homes. Many roads are closed. The fire is expected to remain a threat throughout Wednesday. Coming up later, Brian Bush joins me with an update on the Russian warplane shot down over Turkey. But up next, Pastor Mark Lantz has the conclusion of his teaching, how to stay grateful through difficult times. We're right back with more Harvest after this.
Dr. Lester Sumrall was given a global vision to reach a million souls every day for Jesus Christ. To fulfill his God-given assignment, he began establishing the many outreaches of LeSEA Broadcasting. Today, the ministry reaches millions of people in more than 190 nations through the power of television, radio, free Bibles, shortwave satellite, and prayer line. But we need your help to reach millions more. Will you join Partners in Faith and help us spread the gospel around the world? Will you commit to giving a monthly gift of $25, $50, $100 or more? Dr. Sumrall knew he couldn't fulfill his vision without the help of thousands of partners. But don't wait. Become a partner in faith today. Call 1-800-365-3732 or visit LeSEA.com to give safe and secure online. The Bible says he who wins souls is wise. Make the wise choice today to become a partner in faith and help us win souls for Jesus.
Thank you.
we are on the day before Thanksgiving, and I want to encourage you today that no matter what you're facing right now, you can stay grateful. In difficult times, with the news that is swirling around us, we can remain thankful. And that's what we started yesterday talking about, the key to staying grateful. We found it in Philippians chapter 1, verse number 6, where Paul the Apostle wrote these words. He said, "Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ." Now, on this week of Thanksgiving, I want you to be thankful for the fact that God is not finished with you yet. God has never started something that he did not finish. And yesterday we focused on the character of God. We said, "He which hath begun a good work in you." So now let's focus on that second half of the verse, "which hath begun a good work." That speaks of the creativity of God. God is creative in everything that he does. He's a creator by nature. He has the ability to look into the darkness and speak a word, and suddenly there is light. He has the power to bring structure out of chaos and confusion. He has the ability to stand on a boat in the middle of the Sea of Galilee, and he speaks one word, and suddenly all of creation stands at attention and obeys his command. Why? Because he is the creator. And so Paul is telling the Philippian believers, he's saying the creator has begun a new work of creation in them. Because what happens inside of you is so much more important than what happens around you. Remember Philippians 2 and 13, that it is God which is working in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Right now, some of you are facing extreme adversity, but I want to tell you, adversity is your greatest asset, because adversity is developing that spiritual muscle, that fortitude that you're going to need to face what God has in store for you. Because God's seen the end from the beginning. He knows what you've got to go through in order to prepare you for what's in store for your future. God's got great things. Remember what Isaiah said in Isaiah 46 and 9. He said, "Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there's none else. I am God and there's none like me," declaring the end from the beginning. And from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, "My counsel will stand and I will do all my pleasure." Friend, you're watching today, and I know the enemy's tried to convince you that your mistakes have in some way thwarted the plan of God for your life, that you're washed up, you're finished because of the battles that you've had to fight. But I came to tell you that the work that God is doing inside of you is not done. He's just getting started. You are a work in progress today. No, you're not perfect, but you are in progress, and you're going to come out of this difficult time as a brand new creation that God has masterfully worked inside of you. Then Paul finished up the verse with this statement. He said he's going to perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. We've talked about the character of God. We've talked about the creativity of God. This phrase speaks of the culmination of God, because that term, the day of Jesus Christ, can have only one meaning, and that is the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Friend, be assured today, Jesus is coming soon. It's not a Hollywood-made film that says it. It's a prophetic declaration from the inspired Word of God. Did you know there's 333 prophecies of the first coming of Jesus, but there's over 1,500 prophecies of the second coming of Jesus? What does that mean? God is going to work inside of you until the day that he returns. He's never going to give up. So you can't give up. You can't give in. Today, I want you to be thankful. Be thankful that God is working in you. He is never going to give up until the day that he comes as the Master, the Messiah, the Savior, and the King of this universe. Friend, I want this to be the best Thanksgiving that you've ever had. I believe it will, as you get up today and you determine to rejoice in the fact that Jesus is working inside of you. Despite what's going on around you, despite the negativity, you can remain grateful in difficult times, grateful because the Son of God is alive. He's alive in you. The Holy Spirit is bringing new life into you. So get up today, be grateful, be thankful, because he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ.
The number one question that most people ask is how they can be sure they won't outlive their money in retirement. Good question. One way is to set up a source of fixed income that's safe and secured for your lifetime. That's what a charitable gift annuity does for you. Call for a free, personal, customized illustration of how a charitable gift annuity can provide lifetime income that never changes. Call now, won't you?
LeSEA Tours comes to Israel three times a year, February, June, and November. And we want you to join us as we experience the land of the Bible and walk through the Bible, where the Bible literally does come to life. We want to share with you more information at LeSEATours.com about how you can come to the land of the Bible and experience the Bible for yourself. For a free November tour brochure, call 1-800-685-3732 or visit LeSEATours.com.
You know, this is a scene that plays out in Africa literally every single day. As kids are getting food, they're getting an education, they're getting the Word of God. The refugees, they came here literally with nothing. And it's so important for us to be able to continue to do this. Every child, every day, reaching out around the world, touching kids' lives like this right here. But we can't do it without your help. We need your help every single day. So go to the phone, go to the website, be a part of changing lives, just like these kids here. They're so cute, and they deserve to be fed. They deserve a good meal. They deserve an education. They deserve a full life.
Please act now. These children need your encouragement. They need to know they are not alone. Please call 1-877-769-9270 today or visit feedthehungry.org. Help a child know how good a full life feels.
We're here in Jerusalem and have a great opportunity to introduce and to interview the Minister of Tourism for the Nation of Israel, Minister Levin. Thank you so much for being with us today on the Harvest Program.
My pleasure and my honor.
Why is it important for people to visit Israel?
You know, people, when they travel abroad, usually they want to see things, they want to enjoy things. I think when you come to Israel, it's completely different. Coming to the Holy Land is not just a visit. It's an experience. Mm-hmm. It's something that changes you for life. When you feel the earth, when you stroll through the streets of Jerusalem, when you see it by your own eyes, when you breathe the air of the Holy Land, it makes you a different person. I believe a better one. Mm-hmm. And when you come back with an experience for life that really changes you and affects you.
Now you have the three major religions that really are based around Israel. How do you balance the three major religions between everyone?
I think for us in Israel, it's a mission. It's not something that, you know, we are obliged to do, but we see it as a mission. We have to make sure that everyone, whether he is a Muslim, whether he is a Jew, and of course, whether he is a Christian, can come to Israel, can come to the Holy Land, can come to the Jerusalem, can come to the Sea of Galilee, feel at home, mm-hmm. feel safe, mm-hmm. feel welcomed, to worship, to pray, to do whatever he feels like to do, and doing it safely and with all the welcoming mm-hmm. of not just the state of Israel as a state, but also of our people.
You mentioned safety. A lot of people are very concerned about safety. How safe is it to come to Israel?
You know that Israel is one of the safest places for tourists in the whole world. I must understand that when people come here and they stroll in the streets of Israel, of Tel Aviv, of Jerusalem, of other places, day and night, mm-hmm. they say, oh, we didn't know it's like that. Mm-hmm. We didn't think that it's so safe here. I can assure everyone who sees us, mm-hmm. come to Israel. You'll feel safe, you'll enjoy every minute, and you'll come back safely and happily home.
How do we encourage more people to come to Israel?
I believe that the main issue is exposing Israel to people. You know, it's not so hard to come here. Mm-hmm. It's not so costly, and it's not a risk, of course. Mm-hmm. It's safe, it's something available, it's just a matter of decision. And it's something you won't never forget. I think that everyone, every believer, owes to himself at least once in his lifetime to come, to board the plane, to land in Israel, and to see and feel it by its own eyes.
Speaking more of on a human basis, we bring people from the Philippines to Israel, and one of the biggest concerns they had was not safety, wasn't cost, wasn't the time zone. They were concerned about the food. Mm-hmm. Is the food in Israel acceptable to people?
Completely. You know that we have in Israel people that came here from all around the world because the aim of the country is to be a home for Jews from all around the world. And everyone came here with his own food and with his own tradition. So you can find here really restaurants of all kinds. Mm-hmm. I can tell you that I've been to the Philippines just a month ago, and I felt there at home, also in the matter of food. Mm-hmm. So I can assure everyone, whether it comes from the Philippines, from the United States, from South America, from Africa, you'll find yourself at home. Mm-hmm. You'll find the food that you like, but I think you'll do a good thing if you taste also our traditional Israeli food. I can assure you it's tasty.
I was talking to someone just the other day. They said if I was in Israel, I'd be eating hummus morning, noon, and night. I said, yeah, the hummus is pretty good.
Yeah, no question about that.
No question about it, yeah.
It's not what you buy there.
Right.
You should try it here.
That's right. Now, you're born and raised in Jerusalem. What's one of your favorite places to be able to visit?
I think it's very hard the question, but I think the whole area of the Jerusalem Old City is something unique. When you stroll inside the Old City through the walls, you feel the atmosphere, you feel different. Every stone has something to tell you. Mm-hmm. Every building has a meaning. Mm-hmm. And when you go there in the footsteps of the kings, mm-hmm. from King David and King Solomon, in the footsteps of Jesus, you really feel as if you are part of this history of us all. And I must say that when you do that, mm-hmm. do it not just in the day, but also in the night, because mm-hmm. seeing it illuminated in the night gives you the real feeling that really, you've been to Jerusalem,
sure.
you've been to the place where it all started, mm-hmm. and you've been to the place that all of us feel connected throughout the world, whenever we are.
The last few years, evangelicals have really embraced Israel in a very unique way. How important is the evangelical tourism to Israel?
I think it's crucial. It's not just a matter of what it gives to our economy or what it gives to our hotels and to our restaurants. It's first of all the issue of seeing Israel, recognizing it, and knowing its people. I think that once you do that, you see things as they are and not as they are seen sometimes through the television. And I think that when you come here, you understand much better what happens here in the region and what is the state of Israel and what it really does. You know that I was born in Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. I walked through the streets mm-hmm. of Jerusalem for 45 years. I'm mm-hmm. 46, but mm-hmm. it took me a year to learn to walk, so it's only 45. Uh-huh. And I can assure you that I've never met anyone who said to me, I have the permission from mm-hmm. God to divide the holy city of mm-hmm. Jerusalem, to divide the Holy Land. Mm-hmm. I think that coming here, seeing the united city mm-hmm. is something that changes your views. Mm-hmm. And as I said, the atmosphere and the experience makes you a better people.
I have to agree. Last question. You're new to the Ministry of Tourism. What's your goal? What's the mission of the Ministry of Tourism? What's your mission as the Minister of Tourism?
I think the mission is to make sure that everyone who comes here will enjoy every minute of being here. And I can assure you that once you come here, you'll want to come for the second and
Terrific.
The third time.
Terrific. Well, thank you so much for your time. We appreciate it. Look forward to working with you in the future to better tourism to Israel.
And thank you very much for everything, for all your efforts, for all the good and important things that you are doing. And you know, in Israel, you're an honored citizen.
Well, thank you very much. It's a privilege. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Friends like you have helped send over 700,000 Bibles around the world through our Spread the Word ministry. We're so thankful for your support to help us take the best news of all time to more of those hungry to hear it. Through your generosity, many thousands have already read about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And with your support, we look forward to helping fulfill Dr. Lester Sumrall's vision of reaching the untold billions yet untold with the gospel. If you want to do more and be more, but your stamina runs out of steam, you need the top-selling Essential Vitamin Mineral Pack by Dr. Rodrigo Rodriguez. The Doctor's Making Healthy Choices Essential Pack costs only $59.95, but the health benefits are priceless. You get mineral concentrate, an unsurpassed formula of trace minerals essential to good health. Omega-3 for overall vascular support and healthy brain function. Vita Sprouts, a superior form of multivitamins. And you get Solu-C for a strong immune system. That's mineral concentrate, omega-3, Vita Sprouts, and Solu-C. An incredible value for only $59.95. And if you act now, shipping is free. Call 1-800-965-2345 or go to mhclife.com to get the Doctor's Essential Pack from Making Healthy Choices. That's 1-800-965-2345 or mhclife.com.
It's always an honor to pray for your concerns, and we praise God for friends like you who keep us lifted up in prayer. This month, we covered your prayers for Middle East Television and for all those who are caught up in the turmoil in the Middle East. So many are suffering and at risk. They desperately need to see Jesus. METV is broadcasting Christian programs to millions of people in countries like Syria, Iraq, Iran, and Israel. We get letters and emails every day from people telling us how the programs we broadcast have changed their lives. Some live in areas that are closed to the gospel. If not for METV, they may have never heard the name of Jesus. Again, please pray for this important outreach. And if you feel led to support METV with a financial gift, call LeSEA Broadcasting at 1-800-365-3732. That's 1-800-365-3732. Thank you, and God bless you.
Halfway through this edition of Harvest Time, now to head back over to the Holy Land and get an update on events going on there from our correspondent Brian Bush, who joins us today from Jerusalem. Brian, one day after the downing of this Russian warplane, where are we at now in terms of the conflict in the region?
Well, de-escalation, Chuck, is the word of the day. This issue has complicated the process of finding hope or finding a political solution in Syria's crisis, and everything must be done to further avoid escalation. And it's clear also that world leaders have been directly pressuring Turkey's President Tayyip Erdogan into doing everything Turkey possibly can to de-escalate this situation. One of the complicating factors is that Mr. Erdogan, in his statements, has tied the downing of the Russian aircraft to the Turkmen villagers living in Syria who have been subjected to Russian airstrikes for their attacks against Syrian government forces. Chuck.
Now, one of the pilots is apparently dead. What have you heard about the rescue of the second pilot?
Well, details are not clear on this, but it seems that the second pilot evaded capture by either Turkmen or Syrian rebel forces, or was captured, according to one report by the Free Syrian Army, and then escaped or was set free. Russian forces, we know, sent helicopters to search for him. with one helicopter being forced to land in unclear circumstances, which was then blown up by Turkmen forces, apparently by a missile. But we do know one Russian Marine has been killed in the search operation for the pilot. But in any circumstance, Russia is reporting as of a few hours ago that the second pilot is safely at a Russian airbase on Syrian territory. Chuck?
And overall, Brian, what has been Russia's response to this very serious incident?
Well, it's been quite measured. Russian President Vladimir Putin is upset, but he's also taking the high road on the issue because it gives him further clout in the world diplomatic arena and, of course, in any disagreements with NATO to come. Russia's defense ministry, however, is taking some proactive steps. They've announced that they will be sending their advanced S-400 air defense system to their base in Syria's Latakia province. And Mr. Putin has ratcheted up his verbal rhetoric to Turkey. He's referred to them as accomplices of terrorists, saying further that the political leaders are encouraging the Islamization of Turkish society. Chuck?
Well, and President Erdogan said today Turkey does not want any escalation after it shot down this jet. But he did say it acted to defend its own security and, as you mentioned, the rights of their brothers in Syria.
Well, there's two interesting things in that comment, Chuck. Number one, you know, he's protecting their territory. Well, the radar, as we all know now, is clear that the Russian jet passed over this finger of territory. It was over that territory for moments, and it's clear that the Russian jet was struck over Syrian territory, landed in Syrian territory. The pilots ejecting and landing in Syria territory as well. The second thing that is interesting is that Russia has made this big deal out of protecting the sovereignty of its airspace. But really, the issue is, as I said earlier, the protection of the Turkmen people who are in northern Syria. Again, Turkey wants to protect these guys because they want to create a buffer zone. Remember, I talked yesterday about the no-fly zone over northern Syria that Turkey wants and the Western powers don't. Well, that's because Turkey wants to protect these ethnic Turks who are living in northern Syria. They are a thorn in the side historically of the Assad regimes, President Bashar Assad not being immune to their attacks either. And so that is why Russian aircraft have attacked them to destabilize them and send a clear message. Well, Turkey thought that they would return the favor and send a clear message back to Russia, but now it has really created a tinderbox situation where the next thing that could happen could really blow things way, way out of control. And let's pray that it doesn't. Chuck?
Indeed, we will pray for a quiet weekend over there for all of them. And for you, Brian, thank you very much for your report. Brian Bush reporting from Jerusalem. A reminder that Brian gives us exclusive content from Israel, but it's only available on the Harvest Show Facebook page. So make sure you like us on Facebook. Well, as we mentioned, so much to pray about in the Holy Land, so much to pray about in your lives as well. That's why LeSEA has an international prayer line, but I'm a little hesitant to send it over there right now because we have two pastors side by side in there, Pastor Mark and Pastor Charles. Will we ever get the show back?
Chuck, of course you'll get it back. Usually I'm tossing the prayer line, but I get to be in prayer line today with Pastor Charles. And I just want to say thank you. This is the day before Thanksgiving. Thank you to you, all of your workers, all of your volunteers that are here praying for needs every single day. I just appreciate that. And I know you've got some needs. You've got some praise reports today.
I do.
Amen. Let's take them to the Lord.
Yeah, well, let's do that. Well, we got Nick in Virginia. Nick says, please pray with me. And please pray with me and for me, he says. He says, I have a great girlfriend and we love each other. I found out today that she's pregnant. He said, I need the wisdom of God and his mercy as I repent of my sin and embrace new life. And then we have Carla in Louisiana. Carla says, I called you at prayer line to agree with me that the Lord will walk me through the present situation I'm in. Says, my husband has left me, my family has rejected me, and my house goes into foreclosure December 30th.
Wow.
Yeah. And then we have Robert in Maine. Robert says that, please agree with my wife and I that we conceive a child. We have desired to have children and believe that God will bless us to do so. So far, we have not. And then finally, we have Rich in Ohio. Rich says, I need to be delivered from sexual addiction and pornography. He says, please agree with me that God does it for me because I don't want to be lost and I want to be free.
You know, Pastor, those are such serious needs. And especially, you know, this time of year when you talk about foreclosure, you talk about, you know, relationship problems, people can become overwhelmed with that.
That's right. That's right. And that's why we have prayer line.
Absolutely.
You know, they call prayer line, they get an opportunity to express their situation. And a lot of times, Pastor Mark, that's part of the problem. They don't get an opportunity to really tell anybody. A lot of the churches that they attend, they're so large sometimes that they don't have anybody they can go to. I tell them a lot of times, we're going to refer you back to your local pastor. And they say, well, he don't have time. He doesn't have time. She doesn't have time. Folks, we got to have time one for the other in order for this to work.
And these volunteers do have time. And not only do they have time, they've got compassion.
Yeah.
I mean, these people are here because they want to be here. They want to pray with you. So Pastor, why don't you just take these needs to the Lord? Let's pray together. Let's believe together for these.
Yes, Father in heaven, we just thank you today, Lord God, for those ones who do, Lord God, have the wherewithal to give prayer line a call. Lord, they're calling us each and every day, and we're asking you to meet them at their point of need. Father, they come to us in agreement, and we are indeed agreeing with them, Lord God, with their situations, with those ones, Lord God, who are definitely having children out of wedlock, those ones who are ill in their bodies, those ones who need to be delivered in their souls, even salvation to their families. And we're asking you, Lord, to move and move quickly and let them know that the Most High has visited them. And we will do what we do. We'll continue to praise you, we'll continue to honor you, and we'll continue to lift up the name of Jesus.
Amen. And if you need prayer today, Prayer Line is always here. We want you to feel welcome to call us 1-800-365-3732, or you can email prayer@lesea.com or just go on the web to worldharvest.com. We are here to pray with you today, believing and standing in faith with you for God's favor in your life. I want us to go right now. Let's enjoy a performance from Michael W. Smith from this year's World Pulse Festival and thank God for his goodness.
A little blast from the past. The wind is moving, but I am standing still. A life of pages waiting to be filled. A heart that's hopeful, a head that's full of dreams. But this becoming, it's harder than it seems. It feels like I'm looking for a reason, roaming through the night to find my place in this world, my place in this world. Not a lot to lean on. I need your light to help me find my place in this world. Shine a light for you. somewhere in the night, I'll be standing by. I will be here for you. Yes, I will. South Bend, I will be here for you. Hello. Look who popped on stage. Isn't that amazing? This is so much fun.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Hey, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And when I feel afraid and I think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near to the end. Oh, oh, thy word is a lamp to my feet. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my and I will love you to the end. Oh, oh, thy
many Christian ministries have desired to bring the gospel of Jesus to Israel, to proclaim his message of God's love to the villages and streets he walked while on this earth. Yet only one Christian network has been broadcasting the message of God's love to Israel for more than 10 years. By God's grace, LeSEA Broadcasting has been bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ and the voices of many American ministries to every home in Israel via Middle East television. You can help this great work by becoming a partner in faith for as little as $25 a month. Call today.
Help heal the sick, mend broken relationships, reach the lost with the love of Christ. Do all of that and more when you support LeSEA Broadcasting Prayer Line. Prayer Line is a channel of God's love, reaching more than 10,000 people every month. Your gift today will help keep Prayer Line available for free 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Go to your phones right now and call 1-800-365-3732. Give now and keep Prayer Line going strong.
These days, reading your Bible is as easy as opening an app on your phone or doing a quick internet search. But how do people in developing countries hear the gospel when they don't have access to television, the internet, or Christian publications? The answer for many is shortwave radio. technology that's accessible to millions and ideal for broadcasting God's word to areas where missionaries simply cannot reach or aren't permitted to travel. We're so thankful for your support, which has helped continue the work Dr. Lester Sumrall began 70 years ago. Through your gifts and prayers, we continue to transmit God's word to every major continent in the world through shortwave radio, helping to reach a potential 20 million homes through this powerful technology. Through the support of friends like you, the good news of Jesus continues to be heard by many living in the most difficult to reach corners of the globe. And we thank you.
The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of His hands. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. Take delight in the Lord. He will give you the desires of your heart.
We are trying to show Christ's love, particularly in the Middle East, to a very troubled and turbulent region right now. And that's where METV comes in helpful, because we are able to broadcast our signal into just about every country in the Middle East, and therefore take the salvation message, the hopeful message of the Gospels, into all the world. That's, after all, what we're all commissioned to do, and LeSEA Broadcasting able to do it through METV. We need your help to do it. METV is not an inexpensive operation, and so we're asking for your support this month by calling up 1-800-365-3732 or going online to give safe and secure at LeSEA.com. As you can see from that graphic, not only is METV seen in every cable and satellite home in Israel, but in those countries that are scrolling by on the left, you see countries like Iran and Iraq and Oman and Qatar and places where the gospel is not freely talked about very many times, but METV is able to get it there. And for your gift of any amount, we'll happily send you this little mini book from Dr. Lester Sumrall of learning how to recognize the Antichrist, something that's been in the news as of late. Everybody seems to think the end times are imminent. We don't know for sure. We've been told we will not know the hour nor the day. Right. However, there are things to watch for, and I think Dr. Sumrall's book is helpful in that regard.
Absolutely. He had such insight, you know, well before his time. He was such an insightful man, and I feel like the writings he had on prophecy are just, they're spot on, and he's got some great resources.
I want to ask you, as a pastor now at Christian Center Church, how much of Dr. Sumrall's work do you incorporate into your own pastoral style, into your pastoral teaching?
Well, I've always said, obviously, I'm not Dr. Sumrall.
Right.
I can't fill the shoes of really one of the greatest men of God in our century. Every pastor has to have his own style, but I do reference his material. Obviously, if I'm looking something up, his material is so rich and so deep, but yet it's presented in such a way that we all can understand it. I mean, it's not presented in language that is so difficult for the common layperson to understand, which is what I love, because the truth is deep, but yet the explanation that he used is very simple.
Well, it's one reason why we continue to air his teachings on LeSEA Broadcasting today. Any particular work of his that stands out above any others?
Well, this may sound simplistic, but I love his teaching, just the Christian foundations. Mm-hmm. You know, he's got a syllabus on Christian foundations that goes through the core beliefs of Christianity that so many people don't know. You know, they sit in the pew every Sunday, but they don't know why they believe what they believe.
Sure.
And Dr. Sumrall presents that. Water baptism, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, divine healing, the spiritual gifts, all of those are presented in such a great way for you and I to know why we believe what we believe.
Well, and there are a lot of people probably out there watching right now, Mark, that may not be Christians, or they're thinking about Christianity, they're intrigued about it. And I think now on this day before Thanksgiving in the United States, I realize in 189 other countries watching this show, it's just Wednesday's show. Mm-hmm. It's not the day before Thanksgiving. But I think it's probably an appropriate day for us to make a little bit of a salvation appeal to those who are watching.
Chuck, I totally agree, because you may be watching today and there's an emptiness in your heart, there's an emptiness in your life, and you look at everybody else that is being thankful for all the blessings they have, But you might be saying, Pastor, I don't have much to be thankful for. Well, friend, I want to tell you, with Jesus, you have everything to be thankful for. And the missing piece in your life is the Lord Jesus Christ. And I just want to lead you in a prayer right now. And if you'll just pray this with me, Lord Jesus, thank you that you came, you lived, you died, you rose again. And today I receive you into my heart as my Lord, as my Savior. I believe in you. Thank you for the peace that you're bringing into me. And Lord Jesus, I thank you that today you are my Lord, my Master, and my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen and amen. We appreciate that appeal. We appreciate all of you who watch this show. And everybody who watches the show clearly is not at the same level of Christianity. Maybe there are some who have lived their life as a Christian all their life, and they watch this to get reinforcement or to get education. Other people are watching this to get an insight as to what the Christian lifestyle is all about. We hope we touch on all of these things as we inform you, maybe entertain you. We're not going to go out on too much of a limb there. And certainly walk with you in your walk with faith each and every day. And we hope you're back with us tomorrow for another edition of The Harvest Show.
If ever the Middle East needed to see Jesus, it's now. Please help with a donation today. Your gift will help keep Middle East Television on the air and broadcasting the gospel to millions of people in Syria, Iraq, Israel, and other countries throughout the Middle East. You'll take Christ's love to areas where missionaries are not allowed to go. Please give now to help the Middle East see Jesus. Call LeSEA Broadcasting at 1-800-365-3732. Give now, and we'll say thanks by sending you a copy of Dr. Lester Sumrall's mini-book, Why the World Will Hail the Antichrist. Every believer needs to read this important book, and it will help you understand and prepare for the events that are unfolding in the Middle East today. Give now and share Christ's love with millions of men, women, and children in the Middle East, and get your copy of Why the World Will Hail the Antichrist. That number again is 1-800-365-3732. Call now.
Critical news is happening in the Middle East 24/7, and I am living in the middle of it all, right here in Jerusalem.
Correspondent Brian Bush brings you a front row seat to major events unfolding in the Middle East. Brian knows the people and the land, keeping you abreast of the news with expert analysis from a Christian perspective.
Watch my Israel up-to-the-minute reports on The Harvest Show right here, only on this LeSEA Broadcasting Station.
The Harvest Show is produced by LeSEA Broadcasting and is viewer supported by people just like you. Thank you for inviting us into your home today.